Hello, everybody. My name is Chris Mesa, and I'll be today's host. Welcome to the Aldi SIG Design and Construction Clinic Series. Today's presentation, Lighting Your Layout, will be presented by Bill Neal with the support of Phil Monat and Richard Metz. I'll be muting everyone during the presentation, and Bill will be pausing for questions throughout the clinic. So please put your questions into the chat room, and we'll get to them during those pauses. Without further ado, I will turn it over to Bill. Thanks.
Okay, I was a little concerned when you announced that Phil was going to be here because he's sort of a ringer, you know. He knows his lighting very well, and does it professionally, but that's all right. I've been with the Layout Design SIG for years and years. I was one of the first members in, and of course, you bounce in and out sometimes as your subscription expires. You don't get on it right away, but been a long time member. I'm a member of the NMRA lifetime member also. So I've done a lot of layout design work for people, a lot of layout construction, was part of the Batavia group, and then wound up moving to the Detroit area and building my own layout. And I'm going to talk a little bit about my layout and my experiences in revising the lighting. So with no additional, by the way, I'll be more than glad to handle questions, but what I'd like to do is get through about four or five slides, and I might answer the questions you guys will have as I go, but I will pause and we'll kind of look to see if there's some questions about what I just talked about, and we'll go that way. I soon keep it relatively informal. I think it's a little bit easier to deal with that way.
Hey, Bill, one thing real quick, you're going to get muted for a second, then I'll unmute you when I mute okay. All. I forgot to do that before I hand it off to you. Well, I'm trying to do it. And
yeah, I can still speak, I think, right? Yes. And I'll do a screen share as soon as we get there.
Okay, I'm going to have to go mute everybody's okay, go individually. Ahead. It's not letting me mute all. Okay.
All right.
Go ahead.
I'm going to go ahead and share screen here. And then we'll do a slideshow. Can you guys see? Okay, can you see that now?
Yes, we have.
And can you hear me? I hope. All right.
Yeah, we can. We see it in here, yeah.
Okay, see in here. That's all we need. That's good. This is the thing I like to start all my clinics with. It's a calendar painting by Griff Teller from 1953, and it shows the area that I really model. We're standing in the West Virginia Panhandle, looking across the Ohio River at Steubenville, Ohio. And the railroad that's right in front of us is the Panhandle Division crossing the Ohio. It's come from the east, which is behind us from Pittsburgh, up over the highlands and dropped down in here to the Ohio River Valley, and then crosses here and goes into Steubenville and then goes west from there to Columbus, Ohio. This is really my layout. The sad thing about this picture, it's much later than what I model. I modeled 25 years earlier in 1939. This calendar painting has the last steam locomotive that Pennsylvania Railroad included on their calendars. It's over here on the right-hand side if you look over there. So, but this is a good introduction to what I model and what my interest is. I do model all steam, and I use a relatively narrow shelf layout that is a Nolix up around the room that simulates the helper grade eastward toward Pittsburgh. So, okay, let's see here. Now, one of the things that my friends and I discuss is something called old layout syndrome. Many of you guys have walked down in somebody else's basement. You hear about how great the layout was or is, but now it's a was, because you go down there and the scenery is all kind of dirty and dust covered. It's mostly ground foam. The lighting is poor and gotten poorer as the fluorescents have dimmed and so on and so forth. And sometimes we refer to it as old layout syndrome. And I wanted to make sure that I did not fall victim to that. So I did a number of improvements over the last 2 years. And the clinic you're going to see today is just a small part of a larger clinic I give on layout improvements. We're just going to talk about lighting today, but I'll give you an idea. This is that same area now with better lighting, better scenery, and you can see how bright it is. And it's kind of a lot more pleasant to look at. I'm going to kind of roll into this here. These were the things that I did over the last 2 years. I improved the lighting. I rewired the layout, completely changed the power delivery strategy, and added detection. Then I added working signals. I rebuilt the interlocking plants and rebuilt the control boards for them. I refreshed every bit of scenery there was using newer scenery materials. There was a 5-foot section of the layout that remained undone for years. And I kept saying my layout was 95% done. I got tired of listening to myself say that. Now it's 100% done. I took care of it, got it done. I changed out all the way bills, making them more realistic. Tony Thompson would be proud. I got about 80% of my way there. My wife painted clouds on the backdrop. We refreshed the overall layout look and feel, and I went through and replaced all the older electronics. Now, this was over a 2-year period, and it made a huge difference. But one of the most important things I did was improve the lighting, and that's what we're going to talk about today. When I walked around the layout, I tried to try to look at my layout with fresh eyes. What were other people seeing that I was assuming I saw, but wasn't there? And one of the things was simply lighting. You can see right here in this picture, which is a grab shot of an operating session, that there are dark areas throughout the layout. There are inconsistent lighting. There were some problems with the coloration of the lights that I was using. You can see right here where the sky is sort of greenish looking, because the lights I was using were too yellow in color. So I wanted to fix all this stuff. Wharton yard lighting wasn't bad. There were compact fluorescents lighting it. But if you look carefully, you'll see that the fronts of the cars are dark. Kind of hard to read the car numbers. They had good lighting coming down on the top, but there were dark spots also along the backdrop. So that was another problem I had to deal with. So this is the way it turned out. This is an after picture. Now you'll notice I do mention some other things. I changed away from a fascia color that was layout scenery type to a more neutral color. I don't like layouts painted with a green or a brown fascia. I think there should be a neutral color, but that's just my personal taste. And you can see the clouds my wife added in here, but you can also note how much brighter the layout is and how much brighter the cars are, the faces of the cars are, so you can see the car numbers. Now I'll stop a minute here just for half a second. Does anyone have any questions so far? I mean, I haven't divulged too many of my secrets yet.
So you all have to unmute yourself. There's nothing in the chat.
That means I haven't said anything too controversial yet. That's good. So, all right. So let's roll in here. Again, another example of bad lighting. Here you can see Steubenville. I lit Steubenville along the back with some significant lighting so I could keep shadows off the backdrop. But it created a situation where the fronts of the cars were dark. Over here on the right-hand side, you can see the after picture, and you see how much nicer the scenery looks and the cars look with the better lighting. The first thing I did was go in and pull down all the ambient room lights. I had probably a dozen drop ceiling lights that were fluorescents. And I pulled all those out and put these things in instead. Now, there's probably a variety of places you can get these, but I wanted a 4,000 K light. And these lights were with a CRI of 80%. And I'll talk to you a little bit about that, although Phil's probably better at describing this stuff. I'll give it a shot. And I wanted a Kelvin temperature of 4,000. I experiment with different Kelvins, and I'll explain that in a little bit here too. But I went through and replaced all the fluorescent lights with these fixtures. Now, they do sell tubes of LEDs that'll drop into a fluorescent fixture. It sounds wonderful until you think about the fact that my fluorescent fixtures were in the 20-year-old range, still had ballast running up there, and you had a failure rate that was somewhere around 1 in 10 every 5 years. I didn't want to deal with them again. I'm getting too old to deal with it. I want to put these things up there and leave them. So I replaced all the fixtures. And in fact, they were about $20 at Menards, and you really can't get the LED tubes much cheaper. So I just replaced all the fixtures in the general room. Now, my upper level was lit purely with these fixtures, and I thought that was going to be fine until I got a little further down the line here. I had a lot of, my lat was built, started in the 1990s, so I had a lot of light bulbs with ceramic fixtures where you screw the light bulb in, and I didn't want to change those out. So I went and found some nice LED replacement bulbs, again with a 4,000 Kelvin and pretty decent lumens. I kind of went up to like what you get from a 100-watt incandescent bulb and a decent CRI. I put those across the yard, and it worked out pretty well. Now, again, I'm retrofitting an existing layout. I had originally, I was talking with Chris about this before the meeting, I had originally thought about having lights that would dim. I'd have a night scene where I'd dim the incandescents down and bring up some red lights to simulate sunset, and then bring on some blue lights to simulate moonlight. And I just threw out that whole idea in the trash. Basically, my railroad is too busy to handicap my operators with that kind of nonsense. It looks really, really sexy. And I guess if you're running a short line or something like that, it might be fun. But for the kind of traffic volume I was running, and the intensity of the operation, it really didn't make much sense. So I junked that whole idea. I had put compact fluorescents in. They didn't do a bad job, but I replaced them all with these things, and I'm really glad I did. So that was my first, or actually my second step after replacing the room lighting. Now, I decided I would use some of these LED strips. I went down to Bill Darnaby's layout. Bill Darnaby, you guys probably are aware, it was layout. If you haven't seen it, you probably read about it. He lit the whole layout for a while with just some odd ceiling lights around the room, maybe one every 20 feet. You needed a miner's helmet, you know, with a carbide light lamp to see what you were doing on his layout, his lower level especially. I used to kid him about that. Bill and I went to Purdue together, and we're pretty good friends. So he accepted my joking around with a in good spirits, at least as good as Bill has. And I went down to his layout a couple of years ago, and I was blown away by how freaking nice it looked. The lower level was extremely bright. You could see the really nice modeling that he was doing. It was there all along, but you couldn't tell it was there. And I asked him, what in the world did he do? And he says, well, Phil Monat came down there and said, hey, why don't you use this kind of LED strips? And he bought them, and they worked terrific. So I copied the same process, and I put those LED strips in my layout. Now, what I did was I used these drop ceiling L's. You can walk into any of the big box stores, and for the drop ceiling edge pieces, they're little L-shaped pieces, about 3/4 inch by 3/4 inch. They're aluminum. And I screwed them to the ceiling. You can see here in my little drawing. And I screwed a valence board onto them and stuck the LED lighting strip along there. Works terrific. By the way, when I looked at Bill Darnaby's layout, it was the second time I had seen LED strip lighting used for valence lighting. The first time was over in Kansas City. Steve Priest has a ATSF layout, at least he used to. I think he pulled it down. And he had the strip lighting in there, and he really didn't like it, because you'd look down his rails and you would see dots. You'd see pixelation along the rail. He hated that stuff. I looked along Bill's layout, along his rails, and I didn't see the pixelation. So there's something different about the LED strips that Bill used versus what Steve used. I did some experimenting on that, and I'll kind of get to that a bit here. Here's an example of my valence lighting. You can see the aluminum strip up here wrapping around the room. I screw it every once in a while to the joists that are running along in here. And I then fastened an outer valence along here to give it a smooth, nice look, and stuck the LEDs onto the L girder, the L aluminum section. Worked absolutely great. Here's another picture of it. You can see that here's the L piece screwed into the ceiling. You can see there's an occasional bolt going out here to hold the valence on there. And then I've got the 24-volt lighting supply coming in this way. This worked really well. But I found out that all LED strips are equal. I laid one of the strips that Phil recommended next to one of the ones I bought at the big box store. The big box store had them a lot cheaper, and the specifications on the big box store LED strips were much better than the ones Phil recommended. I thought Phil was pulling my leg for a while there, at least from a distance. He was right, though. The big box strips had 36 LEDs per foot, and they claimed to be 4,000. Okay, in fact, let me talk a minute about the Kelvin range. You can see here, this is a neat illustration of different Kelvins. The white lights are in the 4,000 to 5,000 range right in here. I think sunlight is 5,000 K, if I'm not mistaken. But if you take a 5,000 K LED generated light and you put it down in your basement, it looks pretty harsh. Looks a little bluish. So I went 4,000, which is more of a white light, and worked really well for me. So that's lighting temperature. Now, color rendition index, and Phil, you might be able to talk better to this than I can. But from what I understand, light is generated chemically or electronically by this LED device. And it may not generate all parts of the light spectrum equally. Sunlight is 100%. And when you compare it to sunlight, there are some parts, maybe the reds, maybe the blues, something like that, that aren't as bright as the rest of the lights. And that is how true your light is. It's called the color rendition index. Did I get it pretty good, Phil?
Pretty close. It gets highly technical, but
yeah.
CRI is actually a conscious and subconscious measurement of its appearance via your eye to how you are perceiving the color. It is not a light level or a color term.
That would be
Kelvin. So
maybe I'm saying it wrong then. I appreciate the correction on that. Thank you. I called this picture off the internet that shows the difference of CRI of 90 and CRI of 60. But you're right, it's a perception of how the light looks. So when I looked at the big box store lighting strips, which are cheaper, you go into Home Depot or Lowe's or something, and you buy a color strip that says, oh, it's 4,000 K. The CRI is 90 plus, which is pretty doggone good. Lumens are 330 lumens per foot, and it only has 36 LEDs per foot. It's pretty reasonable. Now, the one I looked at was $65 back 2 or 3 years ago. I thought, this is going to work great. This is going to be cheaper than the stuff Phil was recommending. Man, was that a mistake. You can lay these strips side by side, and there's a huge difference. I went to a company called Environmental Lights after I screwed around with the big box stuff and realized that what Phil was recommending was the right way to go. Environmental Lights has a couple different strips available. The 80 LED per foot one is, this is the part number 4. And it was pretty expensive, about $100 per 16 feet. CRI of 80 plus. Well, that doesn't sound as good as big box store. Okay. But it's pretty bright. And I think Bill Darnaby put it on his layout where he had yards. That was a brighter area. I didn't use any of that stuff. I used the 64 LEDs per foot, which is a little bit more reasonable in price. And you can see how they look. There it is right there, 64 LEDs per foot. And I do credit you, Phil, for putting me onto this. I appreciate it very much. When I compared these two strips that I bought, one from Environmental Lights and one from the big box store side by side, I was shocked. You know, theoretically, the cheap strip should be brighter. It wasn't. Theoretically, it should have better color rendition. It didn't. And definitely, it left pixels on the rails, dots, individual dots, whereas the more expensive Environmental Light strip did not. So if I were you, I wouldn't waste $65 on this thing. I'd spend the extra $15 or $20 and get this guy right here. So much, much better lighting. I'm going to pause a minute and see if there are any questions on this.
Yeah, Bill, I have a question for you. In fact, I have two questions for you, if that's okay.
I'll give you one plus one.
Okay, well, here you go. The first question is, and I might have missed this, I had to answer a catastrophe. So how do you affix your lighting strips to your aluminum background? Do you use some type of contact cement, or do you use, what are you using to do that?
They come with an adhesive backing.
Okay.
And by the way, both of these cheap strip, the cheap strip and the environmental light strip come with an adhesive backing.
Okay. All righty.
Very quickly, the cheap strip let go. And I had drooping lights. I haven't had a problem in 2 years with the environmental light strip.
Yeah. Okay. That was my second question. I got my light strip through Micromark, and the adhesive did not work, and I had wound up having to glue it. That's why I had to ask.
Yeah. Now, one of the things that I also found, Phil recommended it too, was that these strips last longer and work better if they have a little bit of a heat sink behind them. So that aluminum strip that I put them on acts as a heat sink. It really helps quite a bit.
Hey, Bill, one other question from the chat is, what's the size of the layout?
My layout has, it's about 22 feet wide, 24 feet wide, maybe 27, 28 feet long. It has 3 scale miles in it.
And a question for... For me is, it looked like you were using 24 volts. I assume you're doing that for better voltage drop across the thing. But how often were you infusing direct power on those, and how many did you link together?
That's a good question. I think you can put 5 together, if I remember right. They have solder pads. Right. So you just put jumpers in there and keep on going. You can also cut it about every 3 inches and shorten it up if you need to, and use the pieces in the next section.
Did you run that many?
I have one place where I have four.
If I can step in on this before you guys get in perhaps some minor danger. This is low voltage lighting. You need to stay with 24 volts. Do not consider anything that is 12. The reasons are cheap as well as engineering. The second thing with 24 volts is this falls under what we call class 2 codes, which means you're limited to 96 watts per leg. When you order the strip, you need to do the math and find out how far you can go. The environmental products that he was talking about are available in a wide range of wattages. The one that I recommended with the HE is called high efficacy. That means it is maximizing the watts, the lumens per watt, because on railroads, we tend to run long runs. That's, you can usually go close to 32 feet and stay under 96 watts unsupported. You cannot arbitrarily string them together. You will blow the voltage regulators in the strip, and you'll burn out the power supply, and you might even set your house on fire. So you do have to pay attention to the rules.
Hey, can I add something about color rendering indexes?
Please.
Okay. Richard Meads, for those who don't know me, I'm a retired eye doctor, and I do a clinic on vision and aging that many of you have probably seen.
I think I've seen that one too, yeah.
One thing about color rendering indexes, the human eye is not very accurate. So you drive yourself nuts deciding which is better, 90 plus or 80 plus. The human eye is not that accurate. At its best, it's maybe 5 or 6% that can tell a difference. Maybe. So don't drive yourself crazy on that. As long as you're 80 or higher, you're good.
Good. Good to know. I hit 80 and I thought that would be pretty reasonable. It looked really good.
Following up on that, I mean, Richard, yeah, that's a great clinic. If any of you have never seen it, it is wonderful, Richard's clinic. But we use high CRIs in art galleries. We use them in museums. We will use it in color salons when somebody is spending $800 to change their hair color. And more importantly, we'll use it in hospitals and healthcare, particularly in neonatal units, where they're very, very concerned about the accurate representation of the skin color. Everywhere else, it's a way to make money. manufacturers will raise the price of the fixtures, the luminance, if they have a higher CRI. But Richard is correct. Nobody here, and that probably include me, but maybe not because I do it a lot, but nobody here is going to walk in and tell the difference between an 88 and a 95 plus CRI source. Not going to happen. Know.
And Phil, as an add-on to that, your ability to render color changes with age. The older you get, the less accurate you are. Until you get cataract surgery, and then all of a sudden you have shifted into that blue end of the spectrum, and your color, you know, judgment is still off by a different direction.
Yep.
Oh boy.
Absolutely correct.
Look forward to.
So, Bill, a couple other questions. They wanted you if you could put up the tomato slide again, and then also if sure. you had the model numbers for those lights.
Where's the tomato slide?
No.
I think it's very interesting.
Thank you. That's great.
And here are the model numbers. Yeah, take pictures.
Screen capture.
I do recommend the second one. It seemed to have more than enough light for me. And I'm 73 years old, and it just seemed to do the trick for me.
While you guys are looking at that, let me explain it to you, because I spec about $300,000 to $400,000 of this a day through my friends at Environmental Lights. The first number is obviously the Kelvin. And that's your choice. You pick the color. The top one, CC, is color correct. 2835 is the technical spec for the strip. HE is high efficacy. 80 is the LED density. 10 is the width of the strip in millimeters. And then 10M means it's sold in 10 meter reels. The lower one obviously is not color correct. That's a discussion you don't want to go into, but is also the same strip. It is a PL, meaning it's less efficient, only 64, 10, and is sold in 5 meter reels. But there are, last time I checked, about 350 different strips coming out of Environmental Lights. And we specify them to do a wide range of things.
It's an incredible inventory. I just was blown away by it. It's fun to look through.
If any of you guys are going to order there, the head salesman that I use is named Brian Martinez. Great guy. Ask for him. He may, if you tell him you're a train nut, he might give you a break.
Phil, when I look at these LED strips, they appear to have a lens on them, some sort of plastic covering. It's not the LED directly I see. That may help disperse the light a little bit more. I don't know. I'm a little mystified by that, but it's
it is not silicon.
It is a silicon capsule that goes over the diode. As you correctly pointed out, the enemy of all LEDs is heat, and that's why mounting it to an aluminum bracket or an extrusion is essential, because they do get quite warm. They don't throw off as much heat as your standard incandescent sources, but they get quite hot internally. So you always want to use some kind of heat sink if you can. But the standard optical, an LED in a flat tape configuration is about 120 degree optical dispersion. It throws very, very wide. And that cap over the top is there to protect the LED itself.
Okay, it's not for light dispersion.
No.
Okay, thanks. I need to know that. That's good to know. Okay.
Now, as far as color temperature, that is, as Phil knows, a stage design decision. Where your layout is situated in the country kind of dictates what your Kelvin is going to be. So if you're doing Maine, you may be, 4,000 or less Kelvin for a typical day. If you're in Colorado or Utah, it's going to be close to 6,000 K. So that's a decision that you as an individual modeler make, as how bright you want that layout, given your environment you're modeling.
Richard, that's an excellent point. I have a friend that models the Great Northern, and he has a snow scene. And he went to like 5 or 550 to give it more of a colder look. And it was very effective. Okay, that's good discussion. Thanks. You know, guys, I'm an amateur at this, so I struggle a bit, and I appreciate the feedback here. This is good. You're getting smarter by the minute. I just have to remember this stuff now. Okay. I'm getting close to wrapping up here. I want to talk a minute about my lighting strategy. There are places where I have just single level, pretty wide areas, like my yard or junction areas. And I put a ceramic fixture on the valance, and then probably one near the backdrop, near the center, near the backdrop, kind of widely disperse the light. And then I have the two level layouts where I have both the upper and lower valances. I thought when I initially put in the lower valances and put in the strip lighting that would be enough, because I'd use the ambient room lights for the upper levels. But once I put the lower levels in with those doggone strip lights, the upper layers looked like dim fragments of layout. And I didn't like that. So then I went back and I put in upper valances, and I really liked the way it looks. It really, really tied it together pretty well. I have about a 7-foot ceiling and relatively high, like 60-inch second level. So it kind of worked out all right. It worked well. Now, some areas I was not able to have additional lights, and I could have gone through and used those 80 LED per foot LED strips. Probably if I were building it again, I would. But I had an existing situation I wanted to try and retrofit to, and there were ceramic fixtures here on the valance, but nothing here. So I need to throw the light back about 30 inches. And I found these son of a guns. They're called corn cob lights. I don't know if you guys have ever seen these things, but they're like somebody scraped a bit of the sun and stuck it on a light bulb base. And I screwed these things into the ceramic fixtures and it threw the light back. It was a huge amount of light. Threw it back there. It was great. Just don't look at them when you screw them in, because they will blind you for a little while. But there's something called a corn cob light. I thought it was kind of interesting. So this is a picture of how things look. Over here on the left-hand side, I've got multiple light sources, both the valence lighting and center lighting. But here, as you look straight on, were those corn cob lights, and it lit things pretty well. So I was very pleased with the way those work too. So that's a nice retrofit strategy if you needed to have one. So here's another picture. You can see where the lighting has really made things look bright, like middle of the day. Another before and after picture. You can see before it was yellowish looking in the engine terminal. Here now with the 4000K, I've gotten a much brighter, more daylight look. It really helped quite a bit. And also in Steubenville, where I had dark sides to the cars, you can see now that they're much brighter, much easier to look at. And of course, the one area I hadn't done scenery on for years and years became this nice coal patch town. This is the ambient room lighting as you see it with the valance and that 64 LED per foot lighting. And it just lights it up perfectly for me. I just was very pleased with the way this looked. And that, folks, is the end of the lighting section of my clinic. Do we have any questions?
Hey, Bill, can I make a comment for you?
Yeah.
Go back to your where you put your valences in, that one diagram you had. Yes, that one.
Yeah.
What I might recommend for a lot of people, if they're having that dark front to their cars, is you take your valences and you stick them about 3-4 inches beyond the edge of the layout.
Outward.
Yeah. Go outward a little bit on the valences, just a few inches, 3-4 enough, and it lights up the front of the cars.
Yeah. That works very well. Yes. I went directly over. I used a level vertically and marked the joists and then put the valence right along that, but it worked well enough because my tracks are in a bit anyway. So that's worked out all right.
One of the question on the in the chat that actually kind of ties into there. Did you ever consider? It looks like from the pictures you put your LEDs flat against that angle braze, angling that so it was more down towards the front of the front of the layout.
I'm a simple guy. I took simple solutions. I either slapped them up on the vertical. I'm using my hand lower here. Let's see it right here. Either slapped them up on the vertical part or the horizontal part or the vertical part. It made no difference from what I could tell. The LEDs had a wide enough beam angle that it worked both ways. I did not see a difference. Kind of interesting. So I imagine that probably was better on the vertical part, but I did not try and put a 45 degree angle on them. I saw no need to do that with the angle of dispersion that the LEDs had. At 120 degree angle, you got it covered one way or the other. It makes no difference. It's not like a point light source. It's really a pretty broad shoot of the light. What else we got, Chris?
Don't see any other questions, but somebody did put in the link to the environmental light company is in the chat if you're interested in that. I think it to actually to the one you had listed, the part you had listed, if I can read that URL correctly.
Yeah.
One of the things that we did, I mean, we're all model railroaders, and there are some who are, I guess, have no problem with funds, but most of us are cheap. And especially when you're doing this. And when I specify this stuff on jobs, the important thing about what Bill was talking about, Environmental Light sells architectural grade specified LED products. Big box store doesn't do that. Neither does Micromart. That's Chinese crap that they just sell you off at the price they could find. Not that what you get from Environmental isn't Chinese, but there's a bin ratio, there's IES files. The stuff is run through standards because I have to be able to say, I'm going to get 830 foot candles at 14 feet. This is going to give me so many foot candles. Or, you know, it's going to have to, the engineering has to be supported. That's why Bill found out that you get what you pay for.
Yeah.
The second thing is that almost always this product is put in an extrusion. There are, like I said, several hundred different tapes. There's at least 1,000 different extrusions. The extrusions will hold the tape at any angle you want, including the 45 degrees, which somebody mentioned, and all different sizes and shapes and widths, different lenses, different optical manipulations of the 120 degree optic coming off of the strip. I can get them so that they'll throw 10 feet in a very narrow range. There are all sorts of different ways that you do it. That's what lighting designers do. But for model railroading, we want to be cheap. The strip already is not the cheapest thing in the world. And why should I spend more money on a nice aluminum extrusion for an architectural grade? What we did at this process actually started at Jim Udaly's layout, his O-scale layout, and then Bill Darnaby and I did it. We just go to Home Depot and we bought metal corner bead. It's about as cheap as you could get.
Bill
found another solution, just a simple bracket. But what that does is three things. It gives you something to stick the tape to. Once it's on there, it'll stay. Once you put it on, do not try to pull it off once you really stick it on there. You'll damage the strip, you'll break the interconnections, and you'll be hosed. The second thing is functions as a heat sink. And the third thing has to do with the discussion about the angle of the strip. Bill put it on the face of the valance pointed towards the back. I would normally put it on the top pointed down. And I'd put it all the way out with the angle so that the valance and the other face of the angle works as a reflector and throws light back. That directs most of the light straight down. The variances are not that great. It depends on the color of the sky versus the color of the layout. So one other comment in terms of color temperature, and Bill will second this completely. Lighting is objective. everybody's eyes see things differently. You know, somebody says, oh, that's a great red. And somebody says, I don't see any red. You got people who are color challenged. You have people who are aging. You have people in different lighting environments. They see different things. In the theater, you know, we're all over the board in any range and color all across the line. But for layouts, my friend, Tony Kay says he grew up on 4,000 Kelvin cool white tubes. He can't see a layout unless it's under that. You get used to it. There's a layout that I just visited, a guy, he put 5,000 K strips in. That would drive me nuts because it can give you a headache at that Kelvin, but he likes it. Some people prefer that. It depends on what you want. Yes, it's generally true that the higher the Kelvin, the bluer the light, and people associate blue with cold. And there's a medical reason for that Bill can comment on. But regardless, if you're doing fire in the theater, it's a lot of red, right? If you're doing the Arctic, it's blue. But most often, residential use, 27 to 3,000, varying into 35,000. You never go above 4,000 if you want people to stay in there for a long time.
That's a good point. Thank you.
That's an architectural standard.
Yeah.
We use 4,000 and maybe 45, but 4,000 for parking garages and warehouses. 45 only very rarely, high bay industrial spaces, things like that.
So well, that validates what I was, that my experiment, and I liked 4,000 as a nice, comfortable, bright light.
That's good. Your age, and that would be fine. And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, but if you're doing the desert scene or if you're doing something with a lot of warm tones, you have to be careful. I mean, if I look at that beautiful picture, the cabooses, they're subdued. They're punched down because the 4K is killing a lot of the red.
Yeah. You know?
But it's also picking up the blue and the green.
Yeah, that's true. It's interesting, you know. You talk about color arguments. You should hear the Pensy guys talk about what color freight cars should be.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Once you weather it, it all goes
off. I know. It all kind of blends together, you know, the hell with it. Yeah. Yeah.
So we got a couple of questions from the chat room. So one is, what did you use for power supplies or for our recommendation for power, that 24 volt power supply?
I bought it right from Environmental Lights. They offer power supplies that match right up. They plug right in. You know. It's very, very, very easy to put in.
Do not play with somebody else's power supplies. If you're buying an architectural grade strip, buy the power supply that they will sell. They sell a wide range of supplies in capacities, multiple taps, dimming and non-dimming. So you can buy what you want.
There you go.
Don't go take a 24, don't go take a big line L transformer. It puts out, 24 volts and hook it up to it. Because one, you don't RMS what that's doing, and you don't know anything else that's coming out of there.
So. That's good, Bill. I like that.
Did you paint the underside of your, the upper level?
White.
You painted them all white. Okay.
Yeah. You know, you got to have a little bit of help with the lights.
Right, right.
Very, very important. Paint it white. Reflectivity is important. Probably about anywhere in this configuration, probably anywhere between 22 to 30% of the light is reflective coming off of that. If you revert it on the back of the angle, about 50% is coming off the other side of that angle.
Yeah.
So you need to paint it white or use the aluminum anodized stuff if you want.
You know, your comment about model railroaders being cheap, it's incredible, but they are.
Absolutely.
And I think it's so funny. You know, I had a fellow here who models 1955, and he was so proud when he got an engine out of eBay for $1,200. It was a drag freight engine that was probably scrapped by 1916, but it's going to sit on his shelf at $1,200. But he looks at me and says, boy, you spent a lot of money on lighting. And I told him, I said, every train that goes through here is lit better because of the lighting. Every time I come down the stairs and turn on the layout and look at it, every bit of scenery I put on there is enhanced by this lighting. And you just spent twice what I spent and put it on the shelf. Come on, give me a break, you know? It's about the utility of the dollars you spend in the hobby and what it gives you in return. I get animated about that because I think we modelers sometimes spend money in entirely the wrong place. I got another friend that's got thousands, literally thousands of diesel locomotives in 40-gallon tubs underneath his layout. I don't know what he's going to do with them. They're all still in the original boxes. I don't know, you know. But he worries about spending an extra dollar on lighting or control systems, you know. I don't get it, you know.
Yeah, I mean, and by far, I mean, we all don't have, you know, unlimited amount of funds, and we like to spend our money on things that we really can't want, or we really want and can't get, like a custom brass engine that we can't build. But it's the same thing in the theater. No matter how much you spend on the scenery or the costumes or how much you spend on the star on stage, unless you can see the person, it's all bogus.
That's right.
Same thing is true on the layouts. I see people with huge layouts and they got a 2x4 in, you know, drop ceiling grid of, you know, fluorescence, and nobody thought about anything else when they did it. And you know, why are you going to all the trouble if you can't?
I always harass my mutual friend Bill Darnaby about that, you know.
So. Well, that's what started with Bill. I kept going over there and I said, Bill, this is so gorgeous and so much fun, but quite frankly, it looks like hell.
Yeah, you can't see it. Yeah.
He said, I know, I need help. So we went out there and did it on a weekend. It's not hard to do.
You know what? That was probably one of the best things you could have done for that layout. And it's just beautiful, Phil. It's just really lovely.
Thank you. Glad you like it.
Oh, gosh, yes.
One last thing, everybody. LEDs are polarity sensitive. You will not hurt them if you reverse it, but they will not work.
It won't work, yeah. So
pay attention to the plus and the minus. Sure. Pay attention to the class 2 rules. Do not exceed 96 watts a leg. You'd be surprised at 24 volts at 96 watts if you do the math, what that can do if you go over it.
Now, Phil, I thought that was 5 strings, but I'll have to go back and check.
Well, no, you may be able to get it as long as you add it up. But I put different strips on. I mean, in some places when I need, you know, an ungodly amount of light, I'll put a strip in that's 25 millimeters wide that has 4 runs of LED that's putting it's putting out 18,000 lumens a foot, you know, but that's when I really need a lot of light. But if you did that here, you would melt your house.
Yeah, no kidding. Okay.
I just can I speak in for a moment? Or in the cheap category, I found a couple of places on my layout where, for my old eyes, there was a little bit too much light. And I made, I guess what I would call, I don't know if I can explain this very well, some flaps. Okay, you know, like maybe on a stage light, a single light, there might be 4 flaps around the bulb, if you will. So anyway, I just made one because I have, like you've been explaining, lights shrouded by a valance, and then maybe about a foot in front of the light, I put a flap that I could adjust a little bit, and so that could act as a dimmer, if you will.
Yeah, what you're referring to are actually, you know, baffles.
And, yeah, okay.
And in the theater and on stage and movies, I call them barn doors. But, you know, that is a great solution. There are a lot of people who have valances and they put single outlets up there. And there's used to be an A lamp or a CFL. Now it's an LED A lamp up there. And that's great, except when you happen to be able to look down the valance and then your eye can see that source. If your eye sees the light source, Richard and his cat will tell you, if your eye sees the light source, all bets are off because the pupil will immediately dilate down. Because of the brightness. And as soon as it does that, the aperture closes, you know, your depth of field perception changes, a lot of things happen. So you want to always hide the source. do not let the audience see the light source.
Yes. Well, I wish I could do that with the backlight that you're, if you can see.
Well, backlights can have to be sucked up and they can be baffled by different means. It takes a little more design, you know, sensibility. But most people, like the gentleman just said, that's a great solution. I got hundreds of pictures of layouts when they've done that, and somebody just goes up there with a hot melt glue gun and plays around with, you know, foam core. Don't get it too close, but, and it does a great job. Yeah. Cheap.
True.
Cheap.
To bring up the aging thing again.
You got to,
as we're older, we get very sensitive to glare. And a lot of that is what we call veiling glare. And Phil deals with that also, is if you get too much light right on the surface below you, you lose detail. So yeah, if you can valence it away from you a little bit, that's better. Have you ever taken to your layout in a place where you have glare and just take and put your hand over your eyes like this? And you'll notice the colors improve. You have veiling glare. That's where you need to put something.
Horizontal baffles across the layout in places to keep, when you look down the layout, to keep the eye from hitting the light.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
That's what the gentleman did. Right. And what Richard just said, I mean, that the eye is just absolutely amazing. It is one of the most incredible things in the history of the world. But this gorgeous picture is great. And he could raise that by 30 foot candles and it would still look great. He could probably lower it by 20 and it would still look great because it's so adaptable. As you get older, you lose adaptability, but the human eye is incredible what it will take. Most layouts, 15 to 20 foot candles is plenty, but the trick is that, as Richard pointed out, it has to be even. Yeah. It needs to be consistent, because if there's a super hot spot, all the focus goes there. If there's a dark spot, no one's going to look there. Guess what we do in the theater? Don't look over there. Turn on stage left. So same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So want to kind of add on to that point a little bit, or ask a question about that. Our club is debating whether to add a valance above our second stage. Right now it gets its light from the ambient light. It's up on the ceiling. And Bruce online made a comment about the issue. Well, you know, a short person and a tall person, they're going to see underneath that valance different. And we have the problem of, you know, it's a pretty high second level, and that put that valance on top of that. It's kind of in my mind, there's no way to build something that's not going to be able to see the light source under there. You know, maybe if I put it all the way against the valance, like you have it, Bill, but are we defeating a purpose by putting something up there on that light? Because they're going to have exposure to seeing light.
Was that to Bill or Phil?
I think to both. Phil, to you, because you were kind of making that I think it was Richard who made the comment somebody made the comment of, if you see the light, the source, all bets are off.
Yeah, that was me.
Yeah. Right. And so I just kind of looking at it, I said, well, gee, how do I do something that I can't see the light source because it is so high up?
My recommendation is you do it, because your eyes are downward facing toward the train. And you can make this valance that I've got in here. This is like a two inch wide Masonite strip just to smooth out the look of the aluminum, where I've cut seams in here and bent it around. But it made such a difference for the upper level. The worst you could do is experiment with it.
Right.
You know? Buy a $3 aluminum L, a $75 lighting strip, and some cheap Masonite, and put it up there and see what it looks like. You can make the Masonite as long as you want. If you've got a high ceiling, you could probably extend it downward. But of course, the further away you push your light source from the layout, of course, the less impact it has.
Well, yeah, yes and no. I mean, what Bill said is absolutely correct for most modelers. But on those applications, we do put up strips that are 8 to 10 feet away from what they're lighting, and they're in an extrusion with a optical lens that is narrowing the beam. So you can be 25, 30 degrees off of the strip, look straight at it, and the light won't be in your face.
Okay.
The problem is that us model railroaders are cheap, and we don't want to, we'll buy the LED tape, and I would buy the transformer, but we don't want to buy the aluminum extrusion, which can be mildly expensive. But I mean, when you get a special situation like that, you can put a strip 8 to 10 feet away up on the ceiling with what we call a grazer in there, and it'll throw light 25 feet tightly.
All right. Thanks. I think, hey, Ron, did you wanted to say something real quick?
Oh, real quick, just as we're starting to wrap up, to Bill and to Phil and to Richard, thank you. That expert input is fantastic. I'm starting my 7th layout, and I've never had the lights right, so I'm expecting you guys to come on over and we'll get her done on a budget, of course. So, Chris, Chris, thank you for your work and putting this together. I'll just turn it back to you. Appreciate it very much.
Is there anything else we need to cover? I saw a note in the chat room about seeing that corn cob light again.
Yes, that was the last one I saw in there.
Yeah. It's just an intense version of a light bulb. You can screw into an existing. I think I probably would have gone LED strip had I not already had all this infrastructure in place. But I was retrofitting the layout with something, and this wound up being a really massive amount of light that it produced. Of course, it went into a shield to kind of spread the light out a little bit and that sort of thing.
Those are what we call high bays, and that's actually pretty small. They go up to anywhere between 20 to 30,000 lumens. They go up, you know, in ceilings that are 18 to 35 feet, and they usually have larger bases. But because of LED, I mean, you can now... 100 watt A lamp, a CFL equivalent is around 22. When you go to LED, it's about 9.5.
Yeah.
So you can just see the huge efficiency. But they make 100 watt, you know, LED high bays that are putting out close to 18,000 lumens, and that's in what we call that's a high bay housing.
Yeah. It would be close to looking directly at the sun, I think, in a layout. Yeah, you know,
those are usually not for layouts because they're
No. But this was a special case, and I thought it was kind of cool looking, and you know, I tried it out. So there are other solutions that may be even better than this one. So, but it's fun.
There is a question about this. Phil or Bill, anybody know about a good European supplier?
Hmm.
Oh yeah, I use there are several European suppliers, but the trouble is the pricing here in the US for the product is not that attractive. So I usually don't use them. He could, if he wants to email me, he could, because all the specs that we get out of there tend to be fungy a little bit in terms of what they're offering. So I'm at phil@philmonat.com. And if he wants to send a specific question and ask me where, I can try to pull up some. But usually when we go through bidding, they fall out rapidly because of price.
Okay. Any more questions?
There was just one. Did any of these, Lance, you talked about use dimming LEDs. I think, Bill, you said you looked at it, but decided not to do it.
I believe these strips are dimmable. If you had the power supply, was about twice as expensive to be able to dim it.
Yes, the power. If you want to dim it, the power supply will double because it's using it's using a phase dimming supply, which is a little more complex electronically for the LED to understand. But almost everything that they sell will be dimmable. Dimming it is useful if you're into that idea. There are two or three layouts that do use dimming lighting that go all the way down to night. If you've invested in the lighting on the rest of the railroad, yard lights, engine lights, building lights, it can be quite spectacular. But
is that what the Onondaga cutoff uses? Is that what Dave Abels uses?
Yeah, right. But I've had the pleasure of running on both. And Bill, your layout is just one of the most gorgeous I've ever seen.
Oh, thank you.
Dave Abley's Onondaga Cutoff is also beautiful. It's probably a quarter of the size, and it has 1 yard, and the amount of activity in there is not nearly as much as yours, and we get by with switch list and flashlights. That would be a challenge for you, for Bill. Yeah. So I understand why you haven't.
Okay.
I do have a question for Phil or for Bill, and that is, does dimming the LEDs, does it extend their life? Does it extend the lifetime you're going to get out of the LED?
Aha. Okay. Well, there yes, you go. Yes, it does. Most LEDs are binning today between 50 to 70,000 hours of life. So in architectural use, if it's on all the time, that's 7 to 10 years. But for layouts, you'll be done before it dies. If you dim it, it helps the life, provided that the heat sink of the strip is adequate, because as it puts out less power, it doesn't necessarily run cooler. The big thing about dimming is the color shift as you dim it. And I don't want to bore everybody, but as you dim an incandescent lamp, the Kelvin changes. This is not true with LEDs. They do not change. So a 2700 or 3000 Kelvin strip when dimmed tends to look gray. Because as Richard will tell you, as the level goes down, your perception of color changes. And even though the color of the strip is the same, you do not perceive it to be that way. So the manufacturers facing this challenge, and lighting designers have dealt with that. Restaurants, we used to put a 100 watt bulb in, because when you dimmed it down to like 30%, it got nice and gooey and yellow, very romantic. Very nice to have dinner by. That was the way that was doing. In the theater, it was a nightmare, because the color you'd pick if the circuit was on at full would not be the same if it was at 30%. So you were gelling to what you thought the level was going to end up to. With LEDs now, they've faced this fact by coming out with what they call warm glow dimming. And that has nothing to do with what we want to spend money on. You could really spend a lot of money if you wanted to do it linearly. But a lot of the fixtures now are designed with that specification so that when you dim them, they naturally warm up. They go from 3000 to 2200 when they get down to 30%. That confuse everybody?
No, that was great. All right. I think I'm going to call our time. I really appreciate the input from our from Bill and also Rich and Phil for your expertise in the area. I know I learned a lot. I really appreciate it. And thank you very much for taking your time. If anybody else is interested in presenting a clinic on a different construction type, please let me know. I'll be sending out some feelers on that. But really appreciate it. Thanks a lot.
We'll stop sharing at this point.
Thank you.
There we go. Thanks, guys, for having me on. Appreciate it. Yeah, I learned a lot, too, by the way. It's always good to give these clinics, because I have never given a clinic where I haven't learned at least something. Most of the time, I learn what I've done wrong, but it's still good to know.
All right. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thanks, all.
Thanks.